Hello, I'm Jen Wilson, Senior Programmer. Welcome to this Film Independent Presents Q&A for the new Bleecker Street film Breaking by Abby Damaris Corbin. Special thanks to our lead sponsor, the HFPA and Vision Media, who hosts all our virtual screenings and Q&As. And now please welcome director Abby Damaris Corbin. Hello.
Thank you, Jen, for being here. I'm so excited to be here. I'm just jumping on top of your words.
So let's start off, because we have a lot of members, film independent members that are aspiring filmmakers. Let's start off by talking about how you got your start as a filmmaker.
Ooh, a long and winding road with a lot of help. I grew up about as far away from film as well, the analogy doesn't work at this hour, but pretty far away from film. And I didn't even know that it was a thing that you create. It just was magic to me when film came together. It's storytelling I was always engaged in. And I started working at this entertainment technology place. I worked in music. This is all before college. And I was all the while looking on YouTube at these videos of these filmmakers that were coming up. And a lot of them were coming out of AFI, out of USC, and graduates there. I'd applied, I think, for, I don't know, 200 jobs in LA at that point. And I didn't know anybody. I didn't know how to get a job as a PA. I didn't really know what a PA was. And nothing, no hits, probably because I was in Boston at the time, very far away from Los Angeles. And so I applied to USC, and I went to college pretty young, and they took note of my grad school application. And man, once I got in, I went hard. It was grit, go, 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 go. And I met some incredible people, some artists who just, wow, I was able to learn from and grow with. And I just haven't stopped.
It's amazing. Thank you. So Breaking, this movie is based on a real crime that happened in 2017, right? How did you hear about this story, and why did you want to adapt it into a movie and make the film?
So I, like a lot of others, I've come to find out, didn't hear about Brian Brown Easley in 2017 when this happened. I, 2 years later, got a text with the article link. And my friend, my manager actually said, "Hey, have you heard about this?" Because I hadn't, but he knew that my dad is a vet. My dad's a Navy guy who has, like Brian, struggled a lot with the VA. And when I read Brian's story, I read the blurb at a stoplight while I was driving, and I immediately pulled over to the side of the road and read the whole article. It was about 40 pages, and my heart was broken open that I didn't know Brian's story, that Brian wanted to be heard, and he still really wasn't. And so I'm really grateful that not only myself, but John, Kwame, my co-writer, resonated with that and wanted Brian to be heard, and wanted a lot of other veterans who hadn't been heard to have their voices amplified. And so we really were the vessels for those stories. And we're just really grateful that we were able to tell Brian's story. It means so much to his family and to us.
John Boyega gives such a phenomenal performance as Brian in this film. How did you decide that he was your Brian?
Oh, John is a king. He can do anything on anything that I ever do. Wow, he's a man of immense craft. And when I watched his work attack the block early on, you could see that budding hunger, and then you see the progression. You look at Imperial Dreams, you look at Star Wars, and you can see the growth, and you can see he's got a lot more to give than the roles he's had. My co-writer Kwame is the artistic director at the Young Vic in London, and he knew John at a very, very young age. It was he actually met John and gave John his very first professional job when John was 19. It was a one-lined thing that John had to sit in rehearsal for, the way John tells it, like 16 hours. Kwame said it was more like six, but you know, neither here nor there. I wasn't there, so we'll let the most dramatic version stand. But we talked about John because his voice has gravitas, and it has he has a kindness and a deep empathy as an actor. And for Brian, that empathy was really vital, but you also just needed to have an actor in full command of their craft. And John clearly has that. But scheduling didn't work out when we initially approached John. And we unfortunately were just like, well, we know we've got a small window in which to make this film. And so Jonathan Majors was available, and we're like, oh, well, you know, he's pretty phenomenal. But then we had COVID and a series of COVID cases and scheduling consequently shifting. Majors had commitments to Marvel and all these other things. So very beautifully, the person who was supposed to be in the room was then made available to be in the room. And when John and I sat down to talk in earnest about Brian's story, it was just so clear that he was the right person to partner with to tell the story.
So what kind of work did John do to try to get into this character?
Ooh, we didn't have a ton of time. A lot of the work John did was making, as an actor, even before we started together, is making sure that his body, his craft, is something that he has command of. And if he hadn't been doing all of that work before we met, then the work that we did do together wouldn't have been nearly as profitable as doable. But what we did is we sat down together and we went through the scripts, and line by line, we just talked about it and made sure that we understood fully what was going on here. And then we had mountains of research that I'd curated a bit, because you don't want your actors to have this view. You want them to have this view. So John would get a specific part of that. Nicole, Nikki would get a specific part of that. Salinas would. So John got glimpses into Brian that we had gleaned from Brian's wife, and things that she said, hey, Brian moves like a bird in this area. So that became one of our cues for Brian to get into certain parts of him. And then in other areas, she would give us an insight into how he would flare and how his brain would activate. And those chemicals that she was so familiar with, the PTSD side of him. So we had very specific cues that John would navigate through, and it made communication on set between John and I pretty fluid. I had to use very few words because we were really had a strong foundation there. And then we could just kind of activate into each scene and then explore, because you see, okay, this is where we found it, but now that we've got it on its feet and alive, what else can we find?
So you have an amazingly heavy hitter cast in this, with not only John, but Nicole Beharie, Salinas Leyva, Michael Kenneth Williams, the great Michael Kenneth Williams, and Connie Britton, so many incredible actors. But the ensemble that has to do the most scenes together, I think, is John, Nicole, and Salinas. How did you help them sort of figure out their relationship and figure out this little ensemble? Because John is holding the two of them hostage, essentially. But they form a relationship despite that.
John and I talked about this when we were gearing up together. And where we landed is that it's best if the women are separated, essentially, from John, which is where COVID is really helpful for us. And that we had to have people pretty separate for COVID protocols anyway. So I would try and keep Salinas and Nikki more together. And their transportation, their grouping, just little decisions that you can make along the way to keep them together, and then keep John slightly separated. And we built it out essentially in the bank like a stage. So I kept the crew out as much as possible. Also helped with COVID, but still, if you've got a camera in there and the sound in there and keep everything else as minimal as possible, then it's just the actors. And they're actually able to look each other in the eye when those scenes are taking place. So when John's on camera, even if Nikki's not on camera, she's right off to the side interacting with him. And they're firing against each other. So the little electricities that we captured on camera, those are because we were able to facilitate with actors that were generous with each other's time and act against each other. So really curating the circumstances so the actors have the ability to stay within those relationships, knowing that the role that Salinas had to capture has an immense heaviness to it. She had such a hard job in this project because it's trauma after trauma after trauma that she's reliving in her mind and capturing in such a powerful, visceral way. And then Nikki's just trying to navigate those, and the women, their relationships are, their arcs are going like this. But it's very high stakes, and that's hard. So just trying to facilitate, knowing that your actors have to be in that place, and it's very difficult already. And then on top of that, you have all your COVID protocols. So I just tried to facilitate what worked best for each actor within the constructs of the circumstances.
Yeah, I forgot to mention this before. Your cast is so great. You, in fact, won a special award for a acting ensemble at Sundance this past year. Congratulations for that.
Thank you. I'm so proud of them.
Speaking of Michael Kenneth Williams, who I'm sure everybody knows we unfortunately lost last September. Talk about working with him. What was he like?
He's a king. He was a dream fulfilled to work with. And there's so many memories that come flooding back every time we talk about Mike. We had a short time with him. It was a couple weeks, but he has such a big spirit that it permeated into everything that we did. When your elder statesman is the most generous of actors of, I like to think of him as a department head because he's leading the charge, so to speak, with the extras in his scenes. He's making sure that the spirit, the atmosphere is right. That's massive. It's a massive gift to the people that are around him. We bonded over fashion. He's the most dripped man in Hollywood. He turns up in like a dashiki to do like one line off camera, and it's like the most fly thing that you've ever seen, just dripping with flavor and color and spirit. He also smells amazing. Although John smells pretty good too. He doesn't advertise that. He talks about how Mike smells, but John's a good smelling man. But he had so much just courage in the way that he approached people. He was so vulnerable in a beautiful kind of giving way, in a let me see you way. That's what I want to take with me moving forward from working with him, that he sees people and he gives to them in a really lovely manner. He left some incense in my trailer one day. He stole all the banana bread fresh made out my fridge. But I told him, I'm like, it's in there, help yourself. So he took full advantage of that. he was gonna dress me for the premiere, because he's like, girl, you just do not spend enough time there. He's like, you're very functional, we need to like up your game. I'm like, okay, Mike, I need to find something good to wear for him. But it's that I see you spirit that I can go on about for a while.
He sounds like a really special person. Talk about working with your DP, Doug Emmett, to create the look of the film.
Another privilege. Doug, as for those of you that are familiar with his credit, sorry to bother you. I would say that over the walkie. Sometimes Douglas Emmett, the DP of Sorry.
I'm sure he appreciated that.
He did. I went pretty deep into his credits. And then our AD would do that as well. He'd go down the list. The longer Doug took to respond, the further we went into his IMDb credits. Doug's an artist through and through, who understood the spirit of the film and the heart of it, the seeing of humanity that we needed to have here. So there's a lot we could do with the lights. There's a lot we could do with the camera movement, but what we did show was restraint. Doug's a workhorse. He's thoroughly prepared. He, like a lot of us on this project, wants to make sure that all of our foundations are really strong in pre-production, so that by the time we're actually in production, we have the ability to just think and feel. And then as we enact all of the things that we've talked about, we're able to find new, better things. So with him, it was about making sure that the lenses that we chose were able to best go into the actors' faces in a way that it didn't draw your attention to the tech that we were using. It was just pure. The light, making sure that the shadows were reflective of what the actors are doing and picking up the emotion in the best way, getting out of the way so that the humanity can show. And he's really beautiful with using light. He knows simplicity is often the strongest thing you can do, turning on one light as opposed to bringing out the whole truck. A lot of restraint.
The ending of this film is especially poignant. I think that, you know, all the hostage negotiations, and then to end, you know, only with him being absolutely right about what he said all along, which is that he was going to get picked off by a sniper. And he kind of expected that. It felt so inhumane in this film. Is that something that you were thinking about when you decided how to write and shoot this last scene?
There was a couple of things that Kwame and I discussed as we talked with Brian's wife. We were struck by, that we put against the wall too, were the two things were, one, we wanted to capture Brian through a lens of love, through the lens of love of his daughter, of the love that he had for the world, for its potential to be better than people often act. And two, we wanted to capture the reality of what happened that day. And the reality is that there were inhumane things that happened that day. So you have to be honest about the truth. And so that's what we did.
Well, thank you so much for joining us so early in the morning to talk about the film. I absolutely loved it. I know our members probably loved it as well. And congratulations on this. I think you're coming out in like a week or 2 weeks.
We are. 1 week, August 26th.
Well, congrats on the film. And thank you so much for talking with us. It was great to meet you.
Thank you, Jen. It's a privilege. You guys have definitely added to my growth as an artist over the year. And for that, I'm really grateful.
This is Sergeant Bernard. Is everyone all right in there?
As long as everybody stays calm, nobody gets hurt. I have a bomb, and I'm going to kill myself and everybody in here. My commands, and I'm there.
Hey there, this is the Windy Hills Wells Fargo.
Yes, ma'am, this is the Wells Fargo.
Yeah, I need to talk to Bridget about my 401k. I think she made a $9,000 mistake.
I'm sorry to hear that, ma'am. Can I take a message for you? Fraud was committed. The VA stole my disability check from me.
I've had some problems with veteran affairs myself. How about you release one of those ladies?
No. I need everybody to see what's happening here. I need the fire trucks. I need the news cameras.
You have my undivided attention. Standing
now. I don't want the bank's money.
Calling all the people here to see the show.
I'm gonna work this out, brother to brother.
I do not have as much time as you think I do.
Snipers are in place.
Coming through, coming through.
Get the blinds.
Get the lights! What do I need to do to get the attention that I need right now?
Everything you say, everything you do, it matters.
You matter. All you got to do now is just make good, Brian. Just make good.
You ever been robbed before?
Once.
How did it end?